Hey guys, episode 31 is underway. Got the whole gang in the room. AC, Max, and Sam are all sitting around here. We're all properly social distance. I got a bunch of plexiglass. We got plexiglass walls between us so we can't sneeze in each other's faces.
Liar.
Okay, I don't. But so we just finished up that the battle of the party chairs. That was fun. And we'll go into that a little bit more here in a minute. Almost agreement at gmail.com, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. Most podcast providers, if we're not on one you like, shoot us an email and we'll figure out how to get on there. So I want to start off with Todd. I won the bet, and thank you, and I expect that $10 this week. For those of you who don't pay attention to our Facebook page, Todd bet me that Randy Pace would say the Democrat Party. He gave me an over-under of 1.5. I was like, fuck yeah, he's taking the over. I'm taking the over on that. $10. He's like, yep. I was like, sweet. Won that bet.
1.5 what?
The over-under was 1.5 that Randy would refer to him as the Democrat Party, not the Democratic Party. Because that's apparently kind of one of those little jabs that they throw between parties.
The difference between the Democrat versus the Democrat Party?
Democratic Party.
Yeah, you're a Democrat, but you're a part of the Democratic Party.
That's fucking stupid.
I thought it was. I didn't understand it was a thing in the first place. The only reason it came up is because Todd commented on the first time we had Randy on here referring to them as that, as it's a kind of a slight.
It's a slang to say the Democrat Party versus the Democratic Party. Is that what we're saying?
Yes.
Yes.
Correct. I didn't even know that was a thing.
I didn't know it was a thing either, but I just won a $10.
Well, I knew it was a thing that people do say that. I didn't know it was a thing that people jab at people for saying that sort of stuff.
Or take it as a jab upon them when it is said about their people or whatever.
I feel like that my response to that would be, hey, if that's a jab, it doesn't work. You can keep doing it if you want to, but I don't really care. I think that's what my response would be.
Yeah.
You know? It seemed like after the show, they had a bunch of heated stuff. They're like, we should have talked about this on air.
I mean, yeah, and we could. I mean, as we discussed in the text going into it, the intent for me was to make it as, let's find agreeables, let's find what we can agree on.
So let's go over that because none of us were here, and we don't know.
You're not going to listen to it when I post it. I know
exactly. So I'll what did they agree on?
I mean, like you know, like so, like gerrymandering, campaign finance reform kind of questions. Like they agree that and it was what I expected. They agree that they agree on the problems. It's the solutions and where they strongly differ. And it was interesting because like a couple of the other ones, like on the ballot for the county stuff, we've got two amendments to the charter that are on this ballot coming up in November for us in the county. And it's the law director being appointed is one, and then two is whether the mayor can enter a contract without consent of the commission for up to a certain amount of money. And what was really funny is like a lot of the stuff, there's no party stance on. Like the party doesn't have a stance on whether they're for or against either of the amendments. They both agree that they are, that they like that it's on the ballot and that it's a vote for the people. The parties think that it's good that that we the people get to vote on it, but the parties don't have a stance on either issue.
How is that possible?
So the stance is let the people have a stance, but we don't have a stance other than that.
We as a party don't have a stance. This is up to the people. And
is that politically advantageous for them to do that? Is that why? I mean, there has to be a purpose for that.
I don't know.
You know what I mean? Like it seems like they're concerned about being backed into a corner, and so it's just easier then by definition to just say we don't care, even though maybe behind closed doors they maybe do care.
Right. Well, it's the same thing. It's like I'm asking if either party supports gerrymandering, like they're going to say yes to that, even if they do. You know, there's no way they're going to say yes to, yeah, we love gerrymandering. No, they're not going to say that.
Well, they would say yes if they held the majority in that particular situation.
No, they wouldn't say it. They might think it, but they're not going to agree to it and publicly say that they're in favor of redistricting in their own favor by.
So would it be a better question to say, are you in favor of redistricting rather than?
Well, it's not a question. Redistricting will happen. It's an obligation every.
Right.
Every census, that it has to happen.
Right.
So they just like everybody else are under the
it's a responsibility.
Why do you have to redistrict?
Because populations change and move, and you know, I mean, like you know, 10 years ago in Knox County, Hardin Valley was or 20 years ago, I guess it'd be an easier one because I know this one specifically, where our shop is in Emory, there was a fucking airport and nothing. It was a grass airport. And nothing 20 years ago.
Yeah, but we don't do we don't do redistricting of states. You know, oh shit, fucking Colorado has influx of people, so let's Colorado.
They'll change number of reps for the House of Representatives.
Only for the House, though.
Right.
Which is a separate topic because we've went on tirades before about how, well, I don't know if we have, John, a guy that I know and I have had this conversation when we came west back from Portland, was that the state of California has two, the state of Wyoming has two, and my God, two people are representing how many people are in Wyoming, and there are two people that are representing the entire state of California.
Right. In the Senate. I mean,
that's absurd.
Right.
Correct. Yeah.
But it was built that way on purpose. But the House.
I understand that. I'm just saying it's.
Do electoral votes change on population?
As far as for like electoral college stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if Colorado.
Do they? I don't
know. If Colorado has a big influx, they could take away if you know, 30% of California moves to Colorado. So 30% of the electoral college will move to Colorado.
I don't think that's accurate. I need to look that up.
Yeah, there's some kind of weird equation that they do it, but it's not like a one-to-one type thing.
So when does the electoral college for votes of states change?
I would think it would take a decent population change. I'm not exactly sure, but I would think it would...
The state's number of electors equals the number of representatives plus the two electors for the senators the state has in the U.S. Congress.
So it's two plus House. Whatever you have in the House plus...
Correct.
So it's your total number of reps in D.C., House and Senate combined. And so that can change. That can change.
Well, it just seems to the number of electoral votes is what? Anybody?
Total. Like 300 something.
And does that 300 change?
The total number? I don't think so. I think you would just shift. I think that it is possible that like a like right now with everybody leaving California could lose one to Texas or Tennessee or wherever everybody ends up.
So that's the question. Does that change?
I don't. That's a good. That is a good question.
I'm trying to think. I'm looking at it right now. When has that changed? When, because that goes into the smaller view of why is the smaller view changing all the time versus the bigger view? That, you know what I'm saying? Like, right. We're talking about gerrymandering of redistricting, right. All that kind of stuff. Like, how often does the bigger view change?
Right. Well, one of the things is that, and I was reading on this or watching a documentary on it or something the other day, is that each individual state sets up their own election rules and laws and stuff like that. So, like we talked about before in electoral college stuff, there's all or nothing states, there's representative states, stuff like that. That is set up within the state. So, like, voting rules on, like, early voting and mail-in voting and all the different stuff, absentee ballots and stuff, that all falls in the, that all falls up to the state legislatures, and they make all those decisions for their own state. And that's why we have different states have different voting rules, like, you know, like, Matt, when he was in here last time, not earlier tonight, but he was talking about in North Carolina, they have a no excuse absentee ballot. You don't have to give a reason. You just ask for it, and they'll give it to you. Where Tennessee, you have to have a reason to get an absentee ballot in the state of Tennessee, and then you didn't for a minute, and now you do again.
I had to have last election. I had to have a absentee ballot because I went to the area. I changed my election district, and. It didn't go in effect.
Oh, because so you moved, right.
When I went down there, I was like, no, I changed this to this district. So they're like, oh, we'll fill you a, I don't know if they said absentee or something. It
would have been a provisional.
Provisional. Yeah. That's correct.
Excuse me?
Which it really didn't matter on what I voted because other than that whore Marsha Clark. Marsha Clark?
Blackburn.
Is that her name? Marsha Blackburn.
Marsha Clark. It's a little different.
Who's Marsha Clark?
Marsha Clark was the, wasn't she the one? She was the district attorney in California, wasn't
it? Yeah, for the OJ trial.
For the OJ trial.
Oh yeah, that was it. She's a whore too. well, but Marsha Blackburn is.
Maybe
a whore.
I don't know that.
I don't know that.
OJ Simpson certainly was. Just saying.
I mean, pretty angry.
So apparently, this is on PBR, not Past Blue Ribbon. projected congressional reappointment in 2020 based on 2018 estimates. It looks like Oregon, Arizona, Colorado, Texas, North Carolina, Florida will gain at least one. Texas will gain a second. So Texas gains two, and then the other five that I stated gain one. And then the states that will, at least projected to lose, will be Minnesota, Illinois, Michigan, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, New York, Rhode Island.
How has Illinois not lost like 30?
Why would they?
Because people are leaving.
Because that fucking shithole of a Chicago. Like, why would you want to
there's a whole bunch of other state that isn't just Chicago, but...
Sorry if you live in Chicago.
Fact check true.
I apologize.
So that's just an interesting sort of conversation to have. Maybe not right now, but...
No, right now.
Okay, right now. At some point, I mean, there are people that love winter and love cold weather, but by and large, most of the time, people don't like living in, you know, 7 months of snow. And I wonder, as we, you know, as the country ages, are we going to see more folks that live out west and the southeast, and then the sort of rust belt becomes even more rusty? And, you know, is there a, I guess what I'm asking is, hypothetically, is there going to be a point in 100 years where the census indicates that there's significantly less House of Representative members in the north as a result of people leaving those areas?
So what you're saying is, like, I like to go to a strip club. I just don't want to live in a strip club.
I don't even want to go there. The strip club, well, at least with my money. If it's somebody else's money, I'll go. But I don't even want to go to Detroit, really, except just sort of drive through it. And if that's the case, I'm going to Canada, so why don't I just fly?
Well, I think the, I mean, I think the better part of that conversation is the why. If it, I would assume that it's not fully a weather conversation.
Well, sure. I'm just using that as a hypothetical. Right. I mean, I think let's move that out of the equation for a second. I mean, there's no jobs. It said Rust Belt. So it's not just weather. It's also whether access to the blue-collar jobs are not there anymore. I mean, I remember I used to live in Detroit. I don't remember exactly the number, so we can look this up. But Detroit's the only city in the history of the United States that had over 1 million people, and then now doesn't.
Right.
So you used to live in Detroit?
Yeah, I was born there.
Are you a Barry Sanders fan?
Everybody's a Barry Sanders fan.
I mean, like, you go back and you look at some of his stuff, man. Like, he was doing stuff with his maneuvering and agility that was like 30 years before his time. I mean, it was incredible. And his team sucked. So the fact that he was able to do that behind a shitty offensive line and a quarterback that was, you know, would have been a third string quarterback. Like, you know what I mean? Like, some of those teams were terrible.
I'm a closet. So history on me, you know, I grew up in Denver,
mm-hmm.
and I was a Bronco fan. And then at some point, it was probably my brothers. Because, you know, you look up to your older brother and all this stuff, and all of a sudden he was a Redskins fan.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like...
A Washington football team.
I'm sorry, the Washington football team fan. And at some point I was like, oh, like he's not a Bronco fan. He's a Redskins fan. Like, that's cool not being the home team. So for a couple years, I was a Detroit Lions fan because of Barry Sanders. And I had his picture on my wall and all that kind of stuff.
He was a bad motherfucker. Like, he really was.
The team sucked. Yep. Like, mm-hmm. horrible. Like, mm-hmm. but he would lead the league in rushing every year.
Yeah.
I got over that. Back to Broncos.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a raised Packers fan, but I was still a Barry Sanders fan. You can't deny that.
You could put Barry Sanders in today's NFL and he would lead the league in rushing today.
Probably.
I mean, like, if you put Barry Sanders in his prime, he could play in this era of football and have no problems whatsoever.
You know what's funny is about Barry Sanders, like, he was at the top of, like, winning titles with a team that was like 4-7.
Oh, yeah. They were dog shit.
And then all of a sudden he was like, I'm retired.
It was the Calvin Johnson phenomenon. I mean, Calvin Johnson did the same thing. I mean, like, he was still, I mean, he may not have been in his prime, but he was on the down end of his prime. He still could play, and he left. I mean, you just get to a point where you're just like, listen, I could make money, and I could, you know, just kill my body and, you know, not be able to hold my grandchildren at 55, or I could just take my money and make, you know, half of that in endorsements. Like, why would I keep doing this nonsense?
Yeah, exactly.
You know? I don't know.
Well, I mean, Barry never wanted to leave Detroit anyway. Like, he was, I remember there was an interview there asking him about it. And they, you know, said, you know, why haven't you asked for a trade, or why did you re-up contracts and stuff like that? He's like, I'm playing football in Detroit. That's what I do.
Yeah.
And then he called it a career. It's a random tangent.
Yeah. Well, so I try to get us back on track. I think it, you know, so you used to live in Colorado. It seems like Denver has gotten a resurgence over the last 10 years or so of these yuppies that go in there. And like the downtown area, it's a beautiful area. Like, it's a gorgeous city. And I just wonder, like, how do you convince folks, and this is a conversation I would imagine for people that live up north, but, I mean, how do you sort of create that phenomenon for these states that are losing vote or losing people, and then as a consequence losing House seats? How do you create that sort of deal when, like, you know, let's be honest, the Colorado weathers, I haven't lived there, but I would imagine the Colorado weathers are pretty damn rough too. So, you know, it goes back to the point, it's not just weather, you know, how do you create the jobs there? How do you bring the money there? How do you market that to a young demographic that, hey, yeah, you like show up here and this place is really nice in the summer and the spring, but man, like in the winter, if you don't have these, what is it called? Snow, barriers or whatever, barricades or whatever, like you won't be able to even drive. Like they have these wooden sort of things, like mm-hmm. miles and miles and miles and miles and miles down the interstate. If it's not set up, the drifts are so bad that like you don't go anywhere.
Yeah, that stops the drifts from crossing onto the highway.
Yeah,
you know that snow that blows. So those barricades that you watch when you're driving through Colorado, that's what they do. But you know, I think the biggest thing in like, if you want an influx to Kentucky, fucking legalize marijuana. That shit will grow. Like Colorado and Oregon, they were the first two to legalize, and there was an influx of people that moved to those states. And I think California was like, what the fuck's going on? I think California legalized just to stop people from leaving.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Well, then apparently the medicinal was kind of a joke. A lot of people joke, like going like, oh, my eye itches sometimes. We're like, all right, here's your prescription. You now have medicinal marijuana.
It's also a longer conversation about why it's still illegal in the first place. I mean, let's just be frank here. Alcoholism has killed and damaged more families and lives than marijuana ever will.
I'll drink to that.
And right? I mean, so we're still having this conversation about whether it should be legal, and yet nobody's really asking the question about why it's illegal in the first place. Why is the question, should it be legal is the question, not why is it actually illegal?
Well, it goes the same line of coronavirus, like, oh, this shit's killing everybody. We need to stop it. It's all a hoax.
What's a hoax?
Of why the same reason why people are mad at marijuana being illegal.
I'm trying to understand your connection here.
Marijuana being illegal is no harm to our population, but there is a wide government response that marijuana is the downfall of our society.
Yeah, I'm asking the question of why they feel that way.
I don't know why they feel that way, but I think it's the same people that believe that are the same people that believe that the coronavirus is the downfall of the United States. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying conspiracy theory on both.
Okay, so I would argue that that's actually, all of what you just said is actually inverse and bullshit. Here's why. Hold on. I think the people that are for marijuana legalization are not the ones that are saying that coronavirus is a hoax.
I agree with you.
I don't think he's saying it's the same people saying it.
I agree with you.
So
I agree with you.
It's just the same underlying premise. I mean, there's
saying it's the same underlying premise of a government hoax.
Well, I mean, the marijuana one is it wasn't a government hoax. It was a
no. It is.
It was a. It was Ronald not. Reagan. It was not. It was the government.
Marijuana prohibition goes back to the 30s.
And it was an inaccurate, it was a poorly educated government that made it illegal, but it was William Randolph Hearst and his newspapers that were the real key to this game.
I tell you what, I like the fact that this podcast has actually made him look up facts. I appreciate
Wait. Do we know he looked up facts?
He made so William Randolph Hearst is actually a human being that did exist in a previous time.
And owned a ton of newspapers.
Yes. And so even if he sort of in his mind on the fly created that, he's at least smart enough to know now that he can't just sort of bullshit his way through an argument.
Well, Abraham Lincoln said that marijuana has no adverse effect on anybody with all his government studies.
Well, see, I don't believe that because you just arbitrarily picked Abraham Lincoln.
What do you? How did he not pick?
Because I did. I mean, I didn't.
He also said William Randolph Hearst. You said Abraham Lincoln. What's Abraham Lincoln's middle name? It's more information. That's what I'm saying.
Because
he's providing
William
more.
Randolph Hearst.
So at the end of the day, he's providing
serial killer, and so that's why
he was
we
a serial
know his,
killer.
That's why we know his middle name.
He might have been
like,
but.
Like Captain Crunch, serial killer. Like,
no.
What are you talking about?
Captain Crunch. We don't know his middle name. You always know
it's no. Captain name. Crunch the cereal.
Yes, he was not a serial killer.
I don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
Because you serial killers, you know their middle name. That's
do we?
Yes.
What's Kaczynski's middle name?
What?
What's Kaczynski's
Ted?
Middle?
He wasn't a serial killer.
He was a terrorist, a domestic terrorist.
I was trying to let him go into this. That's why I put my hand up. You couldn't see that.
Name a serial killer.
I don't know if I can.
John Wayne Gacy.
Wayne.
I don't know if that's right, but I just it's something. John, it's something Gacy. Is that right?
John
it
Wayne
is.
Gacy?
Yes. It is.
Is it John Wayne Gacy?
Yeah.
I knew it was.
Yeah, that was him.
Well, you're the one asking for it. You give us a serial killer's
I'm
name.
I'm saying.
Jeffrey Dahmer.
What's Jeffrey Dahmer's middle name?
Jeffrey Ooh. William Dahmer.
Is that his name?
Look it up.
Yes.
Google that shit.
Like all serial killers or people that are assassins for the right. present. Like,
all American serial killers have a middle name.
I mean,
they do, but you only know them,
we know them
when
that's,
they are.
By the way, Jeffrey Dahmer's middle name was Lionel, by the way.
That's what I meant, Lionel.
That's what I meant. Yeah. It rhymes with William.
So
it
is. Do you want me to continue to spin my factual story on William Randolph Hearst? You want me to just leave
okay,
it there?
Okay, go ahead.
Is this the point where we gave him some credit and now he's taking
it
too far?
I got to finish it. Well, I mean, I'm going to let you call bullshit. I'll see if I can. Really, it's about it's more about hemp paper than it is about.
Hold on. This podcast is only fun when AC's here. I'm telling you, it's a lot more fun when all four of us are here.
I have no feelings. It's cool. I'm not offended.
Then, like,
well, yeah, it's more fun when we're all here.
We have
point.
More people interacting.
I agree that it is more fun when we are all here, but it's not unfun when AC's off saving the fucking planet or whatever he does.
That shit's over.
We'll see.
No, it's over. Coronavirus is, well, I guess a hoax, but also
it over. Is. It is a hoax, and it is over. All right, tell us about
the
John
weather's
Mike
getting
Gacy.
Warmer. Oh shit, weather's getting colder. Fuck,
I
we're
know,
screwed.
I know. Yeah. Yep.
Anyway, it was really about paper. It wasn't about the recreational use of it, but they demonized the recreational use of it to make it illegal, so he didn't have to worry about the paper side. Because he owned a bunch of fucking newspaper companies, and didn't want to change over all his. All his printing machines to run hemp paper, and instead of doing all the work to change his printing machines to hemp paper because it was a more durable, cheaper, blah blah blah, easier, more sustainable, all the good things that hemp does, he was like, "Yeah, I'll just go on a," and like he used his newspapers and had articles written about the evil brown people that smoke this shit and kill white women and that kind of shit,
or worse, have sex with them.
Right, right. I think it's rape white women is mm-hmm. one of the right. big headlines that he used and stuff right. like that. Right. And so, and then between his newspaper and his ability to manipulate the press because he was the press and his influence on national politics, he got it to become a class one substance. And that's how we got here.
Okay. What's that video?
Truth is.
Huh?
I don't know. Yeah, that's the story. So.
You sticking to it?
I'm just more interested in this idea that the people that think that it should remain illegal typically are the ones that are the more conservative folks on the spectrum. I just find that interesting that the conservative values folks, populace, are okay with alcohol.
Well, I think one of the things too, though, is I think we're getting to the. I think one of the reasons it's opened up in the last couple of years is the generations that. Were brought up in that format that Hearst put in place. Their parents are the ones that saw that firsthand and that media push against it. And so their parents lean that down onto their kids. And so our grandparents, I mean, depending on where our parents are, but our grandparent kind of that kind of gap area is the first generation post the push against it. And so I think that's why it's becoming more acceptable now, because we're not, it's far enough back that we're like, no, those stupid old people, they don't know anything.
Sure, but I think that happened. I mean, I think that's a typical sort of format for anything that changes over a period of time. I just think as a blanket statement, I think it's interesting that, you know, the folks that are staunch advocates, staunchly opposed to marijuana are typically the folks that have a Bible with their name in it, like on the front cover.
Right. I agree with you.
I don't understand how that's. I guess I'm more concerned about the sort of the implicit danger involved in that. That if you can convince people that it's immoral to do something, even if it's not stated in some holy book, then like they'll be against it for generations.
Well, I mean, there's arguments. Well,
I think it's more somebody that you think is a knowledgeable person, like a priest or a government official, that says, oh, this is not good for you. And people are like, oh yeah, that guy's the smartest person in the world. We gotta listen to him. So, I mean, it's the fucking sheep kind of thing.
I mean, there's good argument that most, if not all, major religions have a psychotropic part in their history, whether it's been edited out over time or not. But I mean, there's very good argument for like actual like historic archaeological arguments that Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, specific, probably the most of them, but and then a lot of your quote pagan religions of the Americas, ancient Americas, whatever, that all were very active in using psychotropic drugs as part of their religious practices.
Like peyote.
And then we've, you know, that's been edited out over time through society. Just,
I'm not disagreeing with that. I'm trying to figure out what the point of that was.
I don't know.
Just a statement?
Fun little fact.
Okay.
I know things.
I guess I was just thinking.
William Randall Hearst.
Right. Jeffrey William Dahmer. Part of what I was thinking in that moment was, I think society at large has had a history of that, and it doesn't really matter if there's like a central figure that they're worshiping, or whether we're congregating as a unified sort of spectrum. I don't know what you clowns are doing right now. Okay, we're back, I think.
we never left. What are you talking about?
Well, it doesn't matter. I guess what I'm saying is the psychotropic thing has just been a part of humankind, period. It doesn't matter if there's a spiritual component or not. That's my point.
Gotcha. So, no, I mean, I to go back to your more original point is why the conservative side of the aisle seems to push against it. I find it curious as well. I think there's a business part of it that's an issue. I think there's a fear of a, not a new industry, but it would be functionally a new industry when it kicks in.
Why is it a fear?
Just who gets to make the money off it?
I would say that's the only side of the conservative side that I think that if you are a big businessman, I mean, not saying that big businessmen don't do lines of coke off a stripper's ass, but it's typically not a pothead.
Oh, I'm not saying that, but I get what you're saying. But I'm saying more it's a, you know the Hearst example being
they don't know how to make money off of it. So
right, big pharma hates it.
Yeah, big pharma hates it.
Big tobacco hates it. Big alcohol hates it because it's going to take sales from them.
It is, because when I smoke weed, I don't drink.
We don't admit to doing illegal activities on the show. I don't know what you're talking about.
No, when I'm in Colorado,
there you go,
and I smoke weed
recreationally
in a state that's legal, I don't drink. Like, fuck this political.
I will say,
like, when you smoke, you don't drink. Like, you get high, you know, like, let me get three more beers. You're like, I'm good with my orange juice.
So when I, right. So I stopped in Denver. Let me tell you, like, the setup that they have there for the legalization of the sale of that sort of thing, pretty spectacular, actually. Mm-hmm. Like, you go in, they ask for your ID, you got to sign in, they scan it. You get in the, you go down this little back area into this opened sort of glass, almost like you're at Zales, and you speak to a customer service person, and they say, "What are you looking for, and how much?" And like
a bud tender.
Is that really what it's called?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. But it was, it was a great experience, actually. I mean, like they've nailed it. Like as a business model, like you would love it.
If you go to, like, I'll be in Vegas here in 3 weeks, and we'll go to our favorite dispensary, and it is a fucking show.
How bad?
Like, you have to get past the first glass doors, show your ID, then you get in there, and then people are like, "Oh, this guy spent $150. He gets to spin the wheel." And then they have this big-ass wheel, and you spin it, and they're like, "Oh, he won a half gram," or, you know, whatever it is you land on. And they make it a show. They make you feel like this is fucking...
They're normalizing it, is what they're doing.
It is.
Yeah.
And absolutely, which it should be, because...
Totally agree.
You know? I mean, you go to a liquor store, and someone's like, "You're getting some Elijah Craig? Fuck yeah, spin the wheel, motherfucker."
Right, right.
"Oh, here's a, you know, a right. shot of, you know, whatever."
So, I don't know. I don't know if we're going to continue to hammer this home or not, but I just challenge the conservative folks who are against marijuana. I would just challenge them to give us or provide a rational objection to legalizing it.
It's always been that way. That's the only, I mean, that's
right.
That's not good.
That's not, yeah, right. Correct. It's not good enough. I mean, if, you know, it's like, if we follow that logic, then, you know, women can't vote and African Americans can't vote. And, you know, you can only vote if you own land and like all the other nonsense things that we've gotten rid of over the years. It just
adds. People that rent shouldn't vote. That's just Shane.
No, I'm saying there was a part in our country's history that you had to own land in order to vote. Like you had to physically own land.
So do you agree with that?
No.
Okay. That's what I was clarifying.
Yeah. No, I don't agree.
I mean, that. So that goes into the tweet, the Mike Lee tweet that I sent everybody.
Yeah.
I mean, because it was interesting because it was, I pulled it out of a Facebook post because one of the other dads at school that I'm friends with on Facebook had posted it, and they're all shitting all over it in the comments. And so the quote from Mike Lee, his tweet was, "Democracy isn't the objective. Liberty, peace, and prosperity are. We want the human condition to flourish. Ranked democracy can thwart that." And so the whole post on my Facebook friend on this was about how stupid a statement that is, which I can't help but disagree with. I think it's a pretty valid statement, because if ranked democracy was the thing, gay marriage would still be illegal in the state of Tennessee, because that was a ballot item that was voted down by the state of Tennessee, but then forced through the Supreme Court. Your previous, all the old voting rules that were in place that aren't in place anymore because we have a right or privilege to vote as citizens of this country,
right?
Kind of shit, you know. So like if full, like I guess that's one of those things that gets lost in translation when we're teaching the American system, is we throw this democracy is the best and most important thing ever. It's like, it's not, we're not a full democracy, and it's on purpose, and a full democracy is not the best thing ever.
Why? Well, good, clarify that.
Well, hold on, before you answer that, if you don't mind, let me just interject and say that much like everything that I have sort of pushed back on the show, the goal of that education and in the education system is not to teach them how to think or teach them how to critique. It's to teach them to be status quo and pro-nationalism. Like the goal is, I mean, that's why you stand up and do the Pledge of Allegiance before you, I don't know if they still do that or not, but we sure as hell did when I was growing up.
They do.
Yeah. So the goal is not to show them that things have progressed and you can criticize how things are and you can make change. That's not the goal of education. The goal of education, fortunately or otherwise, is to, this is how things are, accept them, keep moving forward. Now, I disagree with that, but I think that's how it is.
Right.
I think you have a very, what do you call it? Good point. I don't know. Like, what is that called? Like,
nice epiphany. Job.
You had an epiphany? Or he had?
Well, I had an epiphany of what he said. because...
Go ahead.
Is that crazy that someone had an epiphany of...
I mean, sort of. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. What AC said. Go ahead.
So...
It's good. Go ahead.
Like, I was following you on, you know, what teachers teach and all that kind of shit. And then you're talking about the Pledge of Allegiance and stuff like that. And I've always thought of the Pledge of Allegiance like being a very, like... You know, you care for your country. That's mm-hmm. you know that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. But it's, I understand what you're saying because most teachers, and because I've had six kids that are going through the educational system, most teachers are very, very democratic. Democrat or democratic? What's the proper term? Who am I insulting by saying? Democrat.
Most teachers are Democrats.
Very democratic. Anyway.
Just say left leading. It's easier.
Left leading. So they push that other agenda on the kids. And I would say a majority of kids come out of high school or college being Democrat until they get in the real world and then make their own impression of what they believe. And it's funny because saying the Pledge of Allegiance is more of, if we're going to do Republican versus Democrat, saying the Pledge of Allegiance is more of a Republican state. But you saying that saying the Pledge of Allegiance puts you in, what'd you say? You said
nationalism
nationalism of this mm-hmm. is what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
So being me saying, oh, I'm a Republican and saying the national anthem is a Republican thing to do makes kids put in that mind state of they are a controlled environment of the state. I mean, it's kind of crazy. It's kind of like both sides are working against each other.
Yeah. So a couple things in response to that. I don't disagree that a lot of teachers are left leaning, but I would say that the reason for that is because I think when you go to college, you become more left leaning from college. I don't think high school does much of anything, but I think college certainly does. But I would also say that the teachers don't have any sort of role whatsoever in enforcing the Pledge of Allegiance stuff. But the people that do, the folks that are on the school boards, definitely are Republicans, for the most part, at least in this particular area. And so, you know, the teachers may be left leaning, but the people that their bosses and their bosses' bosses certainly are not.
Well, you know, a great example, my sister, she graduated valedictorian, University of Tampa, very, very liberal.
There you go. Good word.
Liberal? Liberal's a good word?
Yeah. I mean, it's accurate.
Well, I mean, she's a bisexual individual, so I'd say that's liberal.
Dick Cheney's daughter is a lesbian.
Is she a Republican?
Yeah.
Well, cool. Is she bisexual?
I would imagine at some point she's had both sausage and the beef curtains.
So my sister is a taco and a sausage type of person.
Okay.
And so when she graduated from college, she was very, very... on the Democratic side. She graduated the degree in psychology.
Mm-hmm.
She went to work in, I think her first job, she was working with people rehabilitated from prison, that kind of stuff. Then she worked on the kids in like juvenile kids that are bad off. And on, no, well, she worked with drug users for a while. She worked with like methadone clinic for
mm-hmm.
a while,
mm-hmm.
and she did that kind of stuff on and off for, I don't know, probably 5-6 years, and then she was like, "Oh, these people need our help," all this kind of stuff. And then after being in that environment for so long, she was like, "These people don't need our help. They want to be in this situation. It doesn't matter how much help we give these people, they're going to be in that situation." So she went from really, really far liberal for her beliefs coming out of college to not so much my beliefs, but more closer my beliefs. So it's funny that, you know, I think college, mainly college, not so much high school, but college is turning out more liberal people than...
Yeah, I agree with that. Quick clarification, too. I said Liz Cheney. It's Mary Cheney. Still a Cheney, but not Liz. It's Mary Cheney.
It's Mary Cheney. You had to look it up. Liz.
Like, oh, yeah, I was Liz. Like, ah, Liz, it's Mary. But yeah, it's Mary. Still a Cheney. But I mean, you go to college and you, I think really all it is that, you know, if you don't go to, I think for the most part, if you don't go to college and you don't have exposure to other cultures or you don't have exposure to other ways of thinking about the world, and you don't surround yourself by people who challenge your points of view and vice versa, then I think by and large, you just sort of inherit the political view that your parents have.
And so are you saying that, like, I know you went to college for 20 some years. Is that you're kind of, are you think someone for that went to college for like 20 some years believes that versus someone that goes only to college for like 4 years, or like the longer you go to college, you more realize the realization of society versus someone that only went to college for 4 years?
I don't think it's a college per se thing. I just think it's more of an exposure to other ideas thing. Like whether it's community college or whatever. I just think the folks that go to high school only and don't surround themselves with and are not friends with people that don't think like them, which is what you really get exposed to at college, I think those folks are the ones that sort of have the same thought process that their parents have had, and they don't sort of challenge their ways of thinking. So, like, in other words, you go to college and you are around folks that are from different parts of the country, maybe even the world, and somebody that grows up in Wyoming and only graduates high school in Wyoming and they don't go to college and they don't leave their small town and that's where they are, their chances of thinking differently about a particular subject is probably lower than a person that goes to college simply because they still are talking about rodeos and shit on my cowboy boots or whatever else they talk. You know what I mean?
No, I agree with you.
That's all I'm saying.
So, like, you don't have that view. Someone that went to college for 20 years. 20 years? How many years you went to college?
A lot. 17 plus, however old I am, 20 some years.
Exactly. So why is your views different than somebody that went to college for 4 years?
I don't know that it is. At some point,
it is. Absolutely.
Well, then it is. I guess it's solved then. I don't know. I don't know what you're trying to say.
No, like somebody that just goes to college for 4 years, I think is going to have someone that only does 4 years. Doesn't matter of. Well, it matters because you can't say 100%, but a majority of people that do college for 4 years are going to come out more liberal thinking than somebody that does more than 4 years.
I don't get it.
What
would imply that everybody who gets out of med school is a conservative.
No, I didn't say that.
They're just not
that.
As liberal as a four-year.
I never said everybody. I said majority.
Well, I would argue that at least 51% of the physicians that are in this country are probably left-leaning than conservative. There are certainly conservatives that are physicians in this world, in this country, but I would think 49% or less of
Ben Carson.
49% or less of the physicians in this country are conservative. And they went to school for 4 years of undergrad, 4 years of med school.
Are conservative or not conservative?
Or not.
49% or less are conservative. So less than the majority are conservative.
So you're saying 51% of them are...
Left-leaning.
Left-leaning. So I'm calling bullshit on that.
Okay, you can.
So what you're saying is that a majority of doctors making... an exorbitant amount
The money doesn't matter. You said
it does matter.
It doesn't because you initially said it was 4 years versus more than 4 years of education, which is what caused somebody to be more left-leaning. So the money's not the factor based on your original premise.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying.
So you're saying a person... So it's not just 4 years.
So someone that goes to college longer is going to make more money than somebody that goes to college shorter.
I mean, that depends. I mean, that depends. I mean, if we're talking about medical, probably. But I mean,
like you got social work. Well, I mean, you get a master's in social work, and you're still not going to come out making much money.
You got
no, and those people that get a master's in social work are going to work a certain amount of time and then become conservative.
Maybe, but
yeah, after dealing with the piece of shit people,
I don't think so.
Most of the people that are social workers are left leaning.
Well, yeah. My sister was until she worked in that society.
Right.
I was saying, like, if you get a PhD in history, you're going to go teach history at a university, and you're not going to make a ton of money.
Right. No, and those people, anyone who gets a degree in history and goes and teaches in a university are still going to stay in. I'm talking about people that leave the university educational society.
If we're throwing out random stats of 51% or more, then I think that would have to count if we're talking about further education parts. But
are we? So taking a step back, we're having a conversation about what, how our thoughts change as we age. Is that exactly? Okay. I'm just trying to make sure we're all on the same page.
It's. I think when you are on the up and up, when you are in a position of growing your income of value, your mind changes on what you think, or vice versa. If you are in a situation that you are dealing with a social economic situation where you're trying to help people, and then you realize that these people don't want to be helped, that changes your view on what you're doing.
I mean, potentially, yeah. I mean, it can. My original point really was just that if you don't surround yourself with people that think differently from you, then your chances of changing your viewpoints are lower. That was really my original point, is that if your entire family, including yourself, have been in Wyoming ever since Wyoming was ever, you know, discovered as a white man territory.
I have family in Wyoming.
Yeah, and I think that those folks have probably voted the same way for millennia.
Well, no, because my family in Wyoming are all teachers.
They're all educated.
They're all teachers, and so they have a different view than me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But they went to college.
But I guess
that was my point. Though.
Right,
they went to college. Right, and they teach in Wyoming.
Right, but so what I'm saying is still correct. So you can stay in Wyoming, but the University of Wyoming is still going to have folks that are from places other than Wyoming.
Yes.
So there's still going to be differences of thought and how to approach life and whatever, because I'm sure that there are some folks that are from Louisiana that went to the University of Wyoming.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So, you know, and it's...
Right, Mitch, what's the fuck his name?
McConnell. He needs to be fired. He's fucking worthless.
I agree, but that's not who I was referencing.
Okay.
What was his name? He used to work with us down on the strip forever ago. Army kid. He left here and went to university.
Oh, fuck, I mean, yeah. What is...
It popped in my head.
I don't know who you're talking exactly about.
Yeah, get him drunk and tell some Army stories. Good God. So I guess the real question is, I guess, and this is something I try to talk to the party chairs about, is what does it mean to be a Democrat, or what does it mean to be a Republican? What does it mean anymore? And this is a rhetoric thing, and it's a catchphrases and kind of shit like that. But that's one of the problems I'm having. You know, when we talk about left leaning liberals and this, that, or right leaning, why the conservatives care about pot and all that kind of shit. It's like, what are the pillars of the party anymore? Yeah, I mean, obviously Trump threw that shit out the window, so whatever. But I'm just not
going to blame Trump. I mean, right. I'll let you finish, but the real smoke and mirrors thing is obviously it never mattered in the first place. Otherwise, somebody as inconsequential as Trump could come in there and get rid of it in less than four years.
Right, but that's what I'm saying, though. So, it's like, what?
So are you voting for Biden? Is that what you're saying?
We'll have that conversation in a little bit. I knew that was going to come up today.
No, let's have that now.
I'd like him to finish his point. I'm happy to come back to that.
It's like Biden, Trump on this presidential ticket, or all of our different, you know, state rep seats that we're looking at right now. It's like, you know, it's like sitting through that fucking phone call with the state SEC for the GOP as far as like, you know, the Eddie Maness, Gene Auster thing going back and forth. And you know, so the Eddie Maness situation is the Republicans don't think he's a Republican enough, at least the party doesn't. And it's like, I don't like looking at his record and at least his rhetoric and all the information that he's putting out and stuff. He sounds like the Republican that I thought was a Republican, but I don't know what it is. Like, that's part of my issue, I guess, is I don't know what it is to have that label anymore.
Yeah. I think it's fascinating to me that the Republican Party here in this area, specifically, I want to stress this again, even though I just said it, the Republican Party is having a conversation about whether or not a member of the party is Republican enough, and yet none of them are saying anything about the person that's on Pennsylvania Avenue. I think that's interesting. Like, we're gonna have a conversation about whether or not somebody fits the qualifications of being a Republican, whether or not they're gonna be in this office, and yet not a single one of them are having a conversation about whether or not Trump is an actual Republican, which, you know, he's not.
Right.
I agree with you.
So like, It just seems like that seems like rhetoric also. And what it really seems like truly at the end of it is, we may not be able to control this guy, and if we can't control this guy, then maybe he's not a Republican. Like, we're going to use that as a vessel.
That's the same thing with Pennsylvania Avenue, right, too, is that nobody can control this guy. And if that's the bar that you have to cross to be the candidate, then they failed on that one too.
Well, but they could. I mean, I've said this a number of times. Listen, like, I'm not against Republicans. Like, Mitt Romney, I don't agree with his abortion stuff and some of his other things, but like, I don't have an issue with Republicans per se. I have an issue with the clown that's in Pennsylvania Avenue. So there are better options for a person that could be a Republican in office right now as the president. And that was decided upon by the leaders of the Republican Party. They went along with it. They were complicit. And so, like, why is this section of, I know it's a very small section and ultimately doesn't matter, but why are we concerned about whether Eddie Maness is a true Republican? What is it about this group of Republicans that say that that is a thing here for this particular candidate, but not so much for the one that's currently in office?
Right. Well, I mean, part of it's the way that the parties break down structures throughout.
I don't agree with that. I think they made their decision work backwards. That's truly how I feel that this is happening. Like, I feel like they made their decision that Eddie Maness is not a Republican. They figured out a way to move backwards and say, well, it's because of these things right here and based on his voting record. And
I think the difference between Trump and the Eddie Maness thing is Trump was elected.
Go ahead.
And the Republican Party doesn't know what to do. Like,
He
ran as a Republican, so, and people voted for him as a Republican, so we've got to back this guy because he's the president now. Like, I mean, did you watch the debate?
Oh, Jesus. I was hoping to
get it. It was a shit show. It was a shit show.
Like, South Park could not have done a better comical. Like, when I was watching, I was laughing. And I was like, what the fuck is going on here? Like, the moderator had no control. And my favorite part, when the moderator was like, we're going to talk about racism, but you guys are going to talk about whatever the hell you want anyway. So go ahead, President Trump. You got your 2 minutes. Like, he completely lost control. It was...
Right. He gave up trying to even pretend to keep it.
It was funny. And at one point...
I think it was a joke, though. I think he was trying to stab that. Like, I think he was like, well, you're not going to listen to it anyway, but the topic is this.
Yeah.
I think that was him trying to poke at him to try to get him back on course.
No, agree. But at one point, I was like, this is the best we have to offer. Like, our country, as great as it is, this is the two guys that we have. Like, this is it.
A lot of other countries saw that too, as well, and they were like, "We're sorry, America."
You know, it was.
I mean, they were literally. Like, I think the whole world's like,
"What the fuck?
We're sorry, guys."
I will say. So I agree with that, and we've had that conversation before. That we've got, you know, two mid-70s white guys that are running for office, which is absurd. But I will say this much: you have two ways of approaching this. If you're debating Trump, you could debate it the way that Hillary did, which was a little more passive, and by a little more, I mean a lot more passive. Or you're more aggressive like Biden, and neither one of them work. And so, you know, I guess what I'm saying is, and I don't want to get stuck on, like, I'm shitting on Trump. because that's the typical response when I'm about ready to say. At the end of the day, you can't debate the guy. Like, he just needs. First of all, we need a fucking mute button. Like the comment, the person that is the what are they called?
Moderator.
Thank you. The moderator needs to have a mute button. Like the fact that we even have this at all has become some sort of fucking political theater. You need to put a fucking mute button out there.
Well, that's exactly why he doesn't want to do the video conference for the next one. I think that's why he canceled, because he knew they can mute him if he was on a video call.
Right.
But seriously, I know Trump overtalked. Biden did the same fucking thing. It was not one-sided.
I understand that. That's not at all what I'm saying. I'm saying that there are two ways to debate Trump. You can do it in a way where you don't overtalk Trump, which is what Hillary did, and she, you know, did not do well in that. Or you can do what Biden did and talk over him as much as he's trying to talk over you. There's no way. What I'm saying is there's no way to have a rational conversation with the guy. You can't discuss topics with the guy because he doesn't shut his fucking cocksucker long enough to determine whether we're actually disagreeing or whether we're just trying to score some sort of political points on television. And so, like, that is my problem. So regardless of whether Trump is a good president or not, he needs to shut his fucking cocksucker, or we need to have a mute button to make sure that we actually have dialogue. Otherwise, there's no need to have debates in the first place. Why are we even doing it in sort of modern America? There's not. We're doing it for sound bites, apparently.
Right, and that's the format built. But my point going back a second was that the state party acts differently than the national party, and that's my response, I suppose, to why this group gives a shit about the Eddie Manis situation. And you're probably right that it was the build backwards thing like you're talking about. But that they want to keep their conservative correctly or whatever on the state level, where the national party dropped the ball on Trump. That's the only point I was kind of getting to there.
So who are they? Like when you say the they is in the local folks or the state folks. Who are they in the state folks?
I mean, it's the Republican Party of the state of Tennessee, and some of those delegates are federal delegates.
That's my point. Right. Is that if there's some overlap there, then which presumably there absolutely are.
Right.
Then that still isn't justification enough for me. You know, I mean, if anything, the concern, Mayor Pete was on Fox News a couple days ago and said this, and the biggest thing that I've had an issue with the Republican Party at large for the last 4 years with Trump is that I really actually was convinced, and maybe this is on me for being naive, I actually was convinced that the Republican Party was the party of values. Like, I actually did believe that.
Right.
And Mayor Pete was on Fox News the other day that said, listen, like, how do we have an evangelical Christian as a vice president that is okay with running with a dude that's had like three wives and has had sex with a porn star? That doesn't seem to jive. Like, it seems like that there was a period of time 15, 20 years ago where the Republican Party wouldn't be okay with that sort of thing.
Right.
And so, like, if we're having conversations about what is it to be a member of the Republican Party nowadays, I don't know if any of them can answer that anyway, because they have hooked their caboose up to the Trump train, and now everything it seems like that they stood for is just smoke and mirrors. It was all smoke and mirrors, maybe.
That is probably the more likely than other. It goes back to what you're talking about, is how, you know, Pelosi will get up there and say some scathing something about some other person, and then they go sit at the bar together and have a drink and eat dinner and chat it up.
I think this is different, though. I think there actually is true animosity now. I don't think it used to be like that. I mean, there were times where you could actually sit down and have a beer with somebody, and like the cameras are rolling, and it's really just, you know, to have a news cycle or something. But I truly believe that now that Trump has incited, just based on some of his rhetoric and the things that he just consistently does, that you know, I don't think the Clintons are not going to go out and have a beer with Trump, even though 20 years ago they did.
Right.
I think that those days are over.
Yeah.
So.
They should, though.
Why?
I mean, and they might be, honestly. I mean, like, conspiracy, like.
The reason why I think that they aren't is because I think that Trump would have already thrown them under the bus in some sort of tweet at this point right now. Anyhow, he's a loose cannon. If it can benefit him politically, he'll do it. It doesn't matter who he runs over.
He's a loose cannon on his Twitter. I mean, that's
I agree. Yeah, I totally
agree. What he was. And if if somebody could control his Twitter and his outlash, I think that the view of how good of a president he is would change.
I mean, I think it can't get much worse. So I mean, I can't argue that it wouldn't at least improve a little bit. But again,
I mean, what bad has he done?
I don't agree with the taking the kids away from immigrant family members that are coming over the border. I mean, I don't agree with that.
Are you talking about what every single president has done prior to him?
And it's okay for me to be against Obama doing that too. But right now, we're talking about Trump. And I'm not okay, with him doing
like,
that.
If you're talking about a situation that someone is following policy from what every other president has followed, you can't get mad at him because you
need get mad at him. I can get mad at Obama too. And you're Bush, right.
So every president that has had that policy, you're against. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with Trump. It has to do with all president.
He's in fucking office right now. He could stop it if he wanted to, and he doesn't.
But right. No other president has. So
it
you
doesn't
can't
matter.
Say,
no other president is in the office right now. He is. Like right. We're not talking about Bush. We're not talking about Clinton. We're not talking about Abe Lincoln. We're talking about Trump. He could do it if he wanted to, and he's not.
Right. Same deal with Trump. Like, I mean, for me, Trump continued the Patriot Act in its almost in its entirety.
I was 100% against it when Bush came out.
I hated when Bush did it.
Yes, 100%.
Obama continued it too. And
absolutely.
But it doesn't change that Trump had the ability. It was on his desk, and he said, okay, let's continue doing this. And that's shitty. I mean, it just is. Now, in some level of fairness conversation, though, if to Max's point, though, is that these two issues we brought up are at least normalized at this point in how things go. And so I guess a better way to try to ask Max's question is, what is something that Trump has uniquely done, not failed to do?
I don't like the removal of the don't ask, don't tell military stuff. I don't really care if somebody's gay and they're, I mean, if they're wanting to serve in the country, I don't really care if they're gay or not.
Okay.
He didn't reveal that.
Yeah, he did.
No, he didn't.
He absolutely did.
If you're gay, you can't be in the military.
He tried to ban transgenders over a tweet. He made an executive order over a tweet.
The really? Transgender issue. Yes.
Which okay. Well, I mean, for clarification,
that has nothing to do with if you're gay in the military.
I mean,
what did you say?
Is the trans issue under the don't ask, don't tell policy, or is it under something different?
The transgender is a whole separate situation.
I mean, I agree that it is a whole separate situation, but AC's point was that he removed the don't ask, don't tell, or whatever, specifically, I don't know what it's called.
So
and then now we're talking about trans issues. I'm trying to stick to the original issue.
Was it Clinton that passed don't ask, don't tell, or was that Bush?
Probably wasn't Bush.
I don't remember who.
It's been in place for a little while.
It doesn't, like, for my personal opinion, like, I don't care if you're gay and you're in the military or whatever. The trans issue is a whole another topic of where you fall in to the military. Like, I don't know. Like, how does that work? Like, we all, when I was in the military, we all shower together. So, does a trans, if you are a female transgender into a male, do you just fall into, you're a male in the military?
I think at the end of the day, and like, you can correct me if I'm wrong because I didn't serve, but I would imagine, you know, if you've never, if you probably haven't showered with every single person in the platoon, and if you have, okay, that's fine. But at the end,
everyone in my platoon, I showered
okay,
with.
Let me finish. I think if there's a person next to you that you are convinced that they have your back, you don't really care whether they're transgendered or not.
No, I agree with you wholeheartedly. Okay. Like, if it was a female and she was fucking naked and showering next to me,
mm-hmm. like, you wouldn't give a fuck.
I wouldn't give a fuck.
Right. And so,
like, so that's the point. Like, there's a great movie. What's the name of that?
G.I. Jane.
No, Boys Don't Cry.
White Boys
no,
Can't Jump.
No.
Seven.
It's the alien
aliens.
Invasion and like
Independence Day.
No.
Crocodile Dundee.
That's no, you guys are.
I'm at least trying to track what
I'm
going to
have to fucking text my wife and ask her, damn it. There's a movie and like the women like has nothing to do with gender. Starship Troopers, yes.
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah, there you go. Like the women are showering with the men. Like it's not a fucking big deal. Like they are showering together.
Right, and there's like 12-year-olds that are in the army in that movie.
No, there's not no fucking 12-year-olds. Now you're trying to get on to your tickle subject.
Well, speaking of that, we've got today's October the 10th. You guys realize we only have five weeks left, and then it's right. Then the four of us will be out. We'll be out before then, but in 5 weeks. The four of us will be at. We'll be doing fucking podcasts from the RV.
I know. I got to figure out.
Well, 5 weeks minus one day, we'll be in the woods because we have a bow license.
That's true.
And then we'll be staying in the RV.
I'll be in the woods, whether I'm.
But anyway, Starship Troopers, they have a situation where they're all showering together and all kinds of stuff. And until you have a situation where, like, you guys are all fucking brotherhood, showering together, whether it's men, women, transgender whatsoever, because in our barracks while I was in, we had a community shower. Like I knew that Larry Long, if you were out there, you had a big fucking cock, and that's why you fucked fat girls, because you said they didn't complain about the size. But you knew that you were around those people, you were in those people. And so having how do transgenders fit into that? I don't know. I'm not currently in the military, obviously. So if you have a female in the infantry, how does she fall into that?
I'll just say this much. I'll say that it worked before Trump showed up, and we didn't hear a whole lot of pushback in the media about that sort of thing. Like, I didn't hear anything about it. Now, so I don't have...
Were you saying that transgenders were in the military prior to Trump?
I cannot imagine that they weren't. I cannot I don't do a census for the military, but like I would bet my life that there were transgendered in the military prior to Trump being there. I cannot imagine that he gets elected now all of a sudden there's an influx of transgendered folks that want to serve in the military like that. I cannot even begin to believe that that's true.
I look at my wrist.
It's your watch there.
So what's today's date?
10th.
10-10-20, bitches, do the math.
So in 20 days, I'll be in Las Vegas, and I will be around Sergeant Major Castle, who was the second highest enlisted person in the Marine Corps.
Okay.
And I will ask him about if he had any issues with transgender. So he cool. would know if they've had any transgender. And so he's retired.
So look for us for our Halloween show. We'll let you know.
We're going back at least 2 years. So his time in would have been the first year of Trump.
So...
So I'll ask him if they've had any issues with transgenders. And he was the second highest enlisted person in the Marine Corps.
Okay. Says trans healthcare has been a small fraction of the military's health budget, with one analysis estimating that the military spends roughly 5 times as much on Viagra alone than on transition-related care for trans troops.
Go ahead.
So in other words, if the argument is we're spending money on the upkeep of this trans sort of lifestyle, the response then would be, well, we spend 5 times as much on Viagra, not just anything else, just on Viagra.
So I'm assuming that's in the VA system, not the active military.
I'm assuming this is everywhere.
Because
I don't know, I'm not sure.
That goes back
the
to
the VA would add a large number of people to that program.
But that's what I'm curious about. But
this is according to the American Medical Association. So that's all I'm
saying. We don't like the American Medical.
My question is, what is fake.
Okay?
So the statement in that is of what was it? Trans Medical Services? What'd you call it?
What?
What did you say it was they spend?
Gender reassignment surgeries.
No, I'm not. What was in the article? The military spends.
Trans healthcare has been a small fraction of the military's health budget.
Okay, so the trans healthcare, like what does that actually mean? What does that specifically mean? Because this is something going back to a conversation from a while ago about, you know, some discriminatory practice from
doctors
against trans persons.
This is another example of in this situation, this is likely Donald Trump making an assertion on how to change something he wanted to change and then work backwards and then filled in the justification. And so this is a Donald Trump quote. Trans people cause tremendous medical costs and disruption to the military. And so the response to that then is trans healthcare is a small fraction of the military's health budget, blah, what I just said now three times in a row. So if that's his main motivation is that we're trying to cut costs, then the response to that is it's not actually a large cost. And we spend, if you're looking at cost, then we need to figure out a way to not give so much money for Viagra. Like if we're really actually having a conversation about that.
Right. I mean, I was so, coming off topic
a
little bit, but
on that.
But I guess so like, but the whatever. I don't. It doesn't matter.
What doesn't matter?
No, just my initial question. What does it mean when it says trans healthcare?
I mean, I don't know. I would assume it's probably some sort of maybe monthly hormone something, perhaps. I mean, like, is yours, you know.
The actual surgeries and stuff.
Like maybe that. Not the surgery itself, but I mean the suppression of your biological hormones that are there at birth.
Right.
That sort of thing. I mean, but again, I think he made his decision and he worked his way backwards. And
right. But I'm taking it out of this specific part of the conversation because going back, I don't know if you were here for the episode or not when we were talking about there's been a bunch of like studies and whatever about discriminatory practices by doctors against trans persons. And my whole conversation when I was trying to understand it was like, well, what is it? What services are there? Like you go in with a broken arm and you're trans and they're not serving you?
Yeah, I think it's more of an endocrine system sort of thing. An endocrine system is like hormone levels and
right. And so, sort of stuff. And then again, then my follow up then is what's the Hippocratic?
Yeah, don't do any harm. Yeah,
blah, right. Blah. And so, and fully conversation sake, whatever you do, what you want with your body. But as a doctor, if you think that this is physically unhealthy for said person, and refuse that service, is that discriminatory?
You're going to laugh, but let me figure out a way to say this. It's going to depend on the individual doctor's operating definition of health.
Like if I get what you're saying. Cause, okay. Right. Cause the mental health included in the whole thing. I get that, but okay. But that's where like the conversation, the past conversation about it, that's where I got kind of stuck on it. It's cause it's like, if I'm a doctor and like, I'm looking at your labs, I'm looking at all this different stuff, and you're talking about transitioning. It's like, okay, I respect that you want to do that or whatever, but here's the deal, buddy. You've got XYZ problems with you. If I start pumping X hormone in you, it's going to do this, this, and this, and it's going to cause damages down the road. And if my job is to keep your body as healthy as possible, this is not good for your body, and I refuse service.
I appreciate your hypothetical, but and I'm happy to go with it, but there's, I mean, we have estrogen in our bodies now. And it's just at a very low level, and so like your hypothetical is like one in a zillion chance that or one in a zillion likelihood that a person that would transition would have some sort of major physiological malfunction as a result of having testosterone supplements.
Okay, that's fine. That's what I didn't understand and was trying to figure out.
Okay, here's a question. So. Does somebody that is transgender, do they have to have a hormone therapy like for their whole life, or is it just
I am not an endocrinologist. I'm also not the spokesperson for the trans community. I will say, though, that physiologically speaking, it is challenging to try to be a gender that you were not at birth if you do not have a way in which to consistently receive a hormone in your body that you don't otherwise synthesize. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So
I was trying to dance around that enough that I'm not, you know.
No. I understand what you're saying. So, but that is enough information for how you danced around for me to go on this subject.
Can't wait to hear it.
I'm going to start this out. Wait, wait. Look at your text message first, because I text you something.
Okay. I saw the middle finger, if that's what you're showing me.
No, look at the second picture.
That's funny. There's two of them. No, there's three of them. Holy shit. There's a lot of them.
So I have diabetes.
Okay. You do, or you say you do?
No, hypothetical. Okay. We're talking about hypothetical.
Okay. Type 1 or type 2? That matters for this conversation. No.
Type 2.
Okay. I would say you need to walk more.
Yeah, I need to walk more.
Okay.
And I need to have certain pills or injections or whatever for my diabetes.
Okay.
So I want to join the military.
Mm-hmm.
And the military is like, you got diabetes. We don't want to have to pay for all this extra shit for you.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not going to let you join the military.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say that's a justification?
No, it's not a justification. I would also say that the military wouldn't say that. But I would.
Yeah, the military would absolutely say that.
I disagree with you. The military would not say you can't come in if you have diabetes.
No, they will say you can't come in if you have diabetes.
I want to see some data.
I would think if you're at a certain point of diabetes where you're requiring injections.
He said type 2.
You can.
He said type 2.
No, there's all sorts of medical screenings.
I'm fully aware of that.
That they will not let you in the military. Because they know long term,
I understand that
there is a cost to you being in there.
I understand that. You said type 2, though, and type 2 is typically a lifestyle thing.
Okay, type 1.
That's different. That's why I asked you that.
Okay, I don't know what the fuck type 1 or type 2 is. You said which type, and I said type 2, 3. And I said okay.
Go with it.
But what I'm saying is, if they know that there is a lifestyle that now I have to pay for, meaning when I say I, the government.
But us in this room.
Which is us, yes, yeah. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Have to pay for, and they want to exclude that because of whatever. You know, that they're making that decision off that.
And I'm saying as a taxpayer who's paying for it, I don't have an issue with a person that is wanting to serve their country. And, oh, by the way, they also have diabetes. I don't have an issue with paying for their stuff.
So what if the person has muscular dystrophy and they're in a wheelchair and they want to serve the military?
If they can pass every other sort of physical qualification that any other person does, then they should have the same sort of treatment.
So
no, because they're not going to be doing PT in a wheelchair.
Yeah, they're not going to be doing PT in a wheelchair.
Well, if they can figure out a way to do it, then that sounds good to me.
I mean, we'll have a...
if I have a heart condition, this is the point I'm making, is the military has all sorts of things that disqualify you from joining the military.
And I would imagine that's probably, they have very good reasoning for that.
That has nothing to do with you doing the job.
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is if you are able to do the job in the military and there is some sort of health condition, whether it's a choice or not, I don't care as a taxpayer that my money goes toward making sure that your health is maximized. I don't have an issue with that. That's what I'm saying.
But it raises the cost of your taxes?
It won't raise the cost of my taxes. But
why?
Well, because it doesn't. I mean...
Well, it doesn't this right now because we are controlling who comes in the military.
If we
open that door for everybody that can physically pass the test but has a medical condition that requires a certain medication for them to pass that test.
I would need to see specific data and, and the diseases numbers, and the numbers
the
for
numbers
me to
would
even,
have to be huge to no, have no, a, no, no. Like, a significant like, effect.
Okay, so we're going to break it down. Transgender person.
Okay.
I'm a male transgender into a female.
Okay.
Absolutely, I can pass the physical test of a female.
Okay.
No, right now I can.
Okay.
Out of shape, I can pass that test.
Okay.
But I need these hormones that are going to cost so much money to continue my thing.
Mm-hmm.
when you could get somebody else who is actually a woman to pass said test and has no additional cost.
Not have to
cost.
Pay that extra cost.
Right. But so you missed, I don't know if you heard the conversation we were having 5 minutes ago. So Trump's justification was a financial justification, but there's data from the American Medical Association with the military that said that there's more money spent just on Viagra, five times as much money is spent just on Viagra for military members than for transgendered folks.
Are you talking about VA or are you talking about
I don't
military?
I'm assuming that it's just military. I mean, like,
I am curious what, if it's active only that there's that many dudes that are in their 20s that need Viagra.
Yeah.
Or they just want to fuck a lot.
I mean, I'll send you guys a link.
Or they're just trying to get free dick pills.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, if you can get them, why not? I mean, you know.
I mean, that's the question. Government's paying for it.
Right, but it doesn't, I mean, I would take them if the government's... I mean, fuck, why wouldn't you take them?
Right, but it doesn't change the base question of it's like, well, they're okay with costs, obviously. They're okay with spending it on all these other things that are not necessary to the job. So why is this one particular one an issue?
That's my point.
Right.
Well, I agree with you. If we're spending that much money on Viagra, that's fucked up.
I don't care.
Don't disagree with
you. I'm okay with us spending that much money on Viagra. Like if it keeps the military folks happy, like, I mean, there are some women that take Viagra. So like I'm okay with that. Like I'm okay with that.
Women taking Viagra?
Yeah, they do it for.
We've had this conversation.
Yeah.
Like you were here. We talked about it.
Nope. Was not.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I don't remember this.
Yeah.
I remember
you
talking
two
about
were
this.
Here.
We were here.
Okay. I mean, and I was drinking then, so it's not like I was, you know.
I don't have an issue with it. They're doing a job that I don't have any interest in doing. And I mean, you know, at some point, I don't want to buy them all, you know, right. Like 75,000 vehicles. But if they're getting Viagra, why would I give a shit about that?
Right. If there was a real fiscal conversation about what goes on in the military, okay. But there's not. That's not the way they operate.
Right.
You know,
if we're going to have a conversation about cutting military spending, it's not going to be whether or not we're going to give some troops Viagra or whether or not we're going to give hormone replacement therapy monthly. Like, if we're having that conversation,
right.
we're not really talking about cutting military costs. We're talking about screwing over people.
Seriously?
It's The Guardian. So.
Seriously?
Yeah, seriously. You're reading it on your phone. Seriously? What's the problem?
The Guardian is not
it's quoted. There's an American Medical Association quote in there. I mean, I don't know what else you want, dude.
So, what?
I mean, I don't know. What else do you want?
The Guardian misquoted that shit. They made it up.
What was that? What was that website you sent me one day?
It's shitty.
The I hate tellheads.com or something like that.
Basically.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
I don't know. So, who are you voting for?
If we were more competitive, if I felt like my vote mattered, I would vote for Biden.
Okay.
Whoa.
So who are you voting for?
Oh, that guy is a
talent. You'd vote for Biden.
If I felt like if it
like right now between Trump and Biden,
let
you
me
would
know,
vote for Biden.
Let me know when you're finished, and I'm happy to respond.
Go ahead.
Fantastic. If I felt like that the split in Tennessee was close enough that my vote may send Trump into office, I would vote for Biden, yes.
So what? Why would you want Biden in office over Trump? Tell me your top three, and don't say, "Oh, Trump does this, Trump does this, Trump fucking Twitter." Tell me,
I have
why
for
you
the
want
record,
Biden.
Not one fucking time have I said that the main reason why I don't like Trump is because of Twitter. Like I'm being a little aggressive on this because not one fucking time have I said that. Like it's not even in my top 10 for him. So one thing, and this is a recent thing, I don't think any leader ever should be infected with any sort of flu, COVID, anything that's infectious, and then bring their infected ass back to the White House to infect other people. Like, that's a fucking problem.
So he knew he was infected with COVID-19 and went back to the White House to infect.
I'm not saying he did it on purpose. I'm not saying he did it on purpose to infect people. I'm saying that he should have stayed at Walter Reed.
I agree.
So what you're saying is,
you know,
so
he has no complete disregard for people that are not him. That is a concern for me. It really is.
He should have stayed where?
Walter Reed Hospital, the hospital he was at when he was getting COVID treatment. He should have stayed there.
Is he dead?
Who's dead?
Trump.
I don't think so.
Not yet.
Is he like on a respirator?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
What's the point?
So I'm just
What's the point? What was your rationale for asking that?
No, because my answer for that is not going to further this conversation any farther. So
I mean, he should still quarantine.
What else? No.
That is one huge thing.
Right okay. There. Next.
I also don't want conservative Supreme Court justices. I don't want Ginsburg replaced by a conservative. Like, that's huge for me. Like, I don't want to remove or potentially replace Roe Wade.
So your
okay. So
your vote is not changing.
Hold on, because this is one that I've put a lot of thought into recently. The last lawyer Jamie episode, we talked about that specifically, and especially coming out of your mouth is with the number of times that you make the rhetoric reference and that it's just rhetoric and it's just a fucking talking thing.
Mm-hmm.
Federally speaking, the abortion issue is 100% rhetoric. Nobody's going to change anything significantly on the federal level ever. All that is base activation talk.
Okay, I don't believe that.
There's going to be a Supreme Court justice before the election happens.
I agree. Yeah.
That has nothing to do with who you're voting for. So next topic.
It does, because it means he can have
like 80, and he's going to die here.
Yeah, it means that he could replace two more, and so, like, you know, 75% of the Supreme Court could be conservative.
Okay, so
I still don't think Roe Wade.
Okay, so we'll go on to that next topic.
I don't think that Roe Wade is going to be overturned in the first 6 months, but I do think you can chip away at it. Like, I don't think this is some magic wand where, you know, Roe Wade is gone by Valentine's Day. But, like, to say that there are not enough cases that are brought to the Supreme Court that over a period of time it is chipped away is naive.
So you think that you want to uphold Roe v. Wade?
Yes.
So if you are 9 months pregnant, you can have an abortion.
You can't do that now unless...
No, absolutely you can.
Can I finish?
Go ahead and finish.
Okay. If there's not a medical reason for that, that is late-term abortion is at nine Correct. Months is not a thing.
Correct.
You are absolutely fucking false.
Show me some data.
Go look up You can Google it. Roe v. Wade.
I'm not Googling it if you're saying that it actually is a thing. I'm not fucking doing that.
Roe v. Wade legalizes abortion up until the woman is in labor. If she is not in labor, she can have a fucking abortion.
I'm happy to read the data.
Okay, even if that's true.
You can look it up. You can look it up. It doesn't matter.
He's asking you to
show him where you found this that is saying this.
And even if it's true.
Because I don't believe it's true either.
I'll post this in our chat. There have been abortions for the
issue of the mother's
health. You saying that nowhere in the United States you can have a third
but a mother
abortion.
Up till 9 months, you can't just like go into an abortion shop and say,
"So I'm done with this.
I'm done with this. I need this out of me."
So
that is not a thing.
That's rhetoric. Like, if we're talking about rhetoric, that's the rhetoric.
Either way, even if it is true, there's been cases and actions since that it's not currently true. Even if Roe v. Wade says that explicitly into what Max is referencing, it doesn't mean that is currently true.
I agree with that. Which is why it's not done.
And more importantly, that if a conservative justice is not going to chip away at the stuff that's backing down this extreme Roe v. Wade conversation anyway. They're not going to chip away the safeguards against this version of Roe v. Wade.
Yeah, which I'm okay with that being there in the first place, frankly. Like, I'm okay with that. My concern is, I don't want the eventual elimination of abortion, period. Like, that's what my concern is.
But my issue with that too, my issue with that in the conversation and using the lawyer expert, which just because he's an expert, I guess we don't have to believe him or whatever. But, you know, I mean, talking to him about that specifically, like the amount, and I guess you're right. It could be chipped away over the number of decades that we will keep Supreme Court justices because they're lifetime appointments. But yeah. I mean, the amount of case law that would have to be overturned is substantial.
And there are also lawyers that do fear that. So I'm glad that we had an expert in here. But there are lawyers that are on the progressive side of things that do feel like that could happen.
All right. I mean,
I don't know what to say to this person except give a response to what that is. I mean, you know, are these people just, you know, cheerleaders for progressivism? Is that all they're saying?
I mean, part of the chipping away, I mean, it has gone down to a lot of the states to individually kind of set their standards on abortion.
Right. Now, that's a real talking point to me.
I want to say Tennessee is one of them that when you go in for an abortion, I don't know what the time frame is, but I want to say now they require you to watch an ultrasound of the baby before you can, you know, either get the pill or, you know, other procedure. You have to actually, they make you go through that before you can have the abortion.
I don't even know how I feel
Some
about
say,
that,
like,
honestly.
You have to wait, like, you know, once you come in, you have to get consulted and then still wait, like, 2 days to think about it, I guess, before
right.
you have it done.
Right. Now, that was state by state, yes. State by state. If
right. That's what I'm talking about. It's right. In that part of the chipping away, because it starts setting precedents. They're like, well, you know, 10 states, you know, have it this way. And then we see other states leaning this way, and it starts chipping away to where, you know, even the Supreme Court, you know, you can't be oblivious to what other states have decided.
Right, but the point is that it is the decision of the state. It should be the decision of the state. It shouldn't be the decision of the Supreme Court in the first place. Against a bunch of laws, not just this one specifically, but as far as the conversation on elected officials and who we care about can make substantial changes to abortion law as it stands, it is our state rep, state senator, governor, who's going to have more impact on your ability in the state of Tennessee to do anything than the federal government's going to have, short of completely turning it over and making it federally illegal. That's my understanding of the big picture of it. Is yes, the Supreme Court could break down the 50 years of legal precedents on the federal level for it, and then make it illegal for states to allow it. But more realistically, state by state's procedures, processes, availability is kind of all the little crap to it. The states are the ones that the state governments are the ones that actually have real impact on the accessibility of choice.
My point is, chipping away is a thing, and if you're getting somebody that is, you know, less than 55, and they're going to be in there for 30 plus years, and you've already given three justices to that, chipping away is actually a thing that is likely to happen, number one. And number two, even if it's just one state, which I think it would be more than that, but even if it's just one state where it makes it incredibly difficult, almost impossible to have that taken care of, that procedure done, I'm against it. 100%. I mean, honestly, like, it's a larger conversation. Like, I think that we need to do a better job of figuring out a way to get folks into the Supreme Court, not just have it be this sort of bullshit fucking, if there's a Republican in office, we're, you know, nominating a conservative. And, like, we've got to figure out a different way to do this, because right now it's unnecessarily politically charged.
Right, I agree with that.
So,
Supreme Court selection.
The Guardian, which you've quoted... Yes. The Guardian, which you've quoted earlier, so I look for a site that you.
I don't understand why we're being shitty right now, dude. Like, we're like, come
no.
on.
No, so like 10% of the abortions in the United States are happening after 21 weeks.
Okay, you said 9 months.
After 21 weeks, third term abortion
okay.
is 21 weeks.
Right, but that says after 21. That could be 22 weeks.
You're right, and they've had babies live at 22 weeks.
I don't think it's 22. I think we're more like 25 or 26. I think. I mean, it matters. I mean, I'm just saying it matters.
So
I'm sure there's cases that have, and there's cases that don't.
We can Google the earliest survival.
Right, but your original point was 9 months, and you said that it was 9 months, and that was what I took issue with.
Up to 9 months, that's what I said.
Right, and I'm saying that 9 months is not a thing. Right now, we've just seen something where it's over 21 weeks. Like, if you show me something where it's like 36 or 40, I'll say, well, fuck, I didn't know that. I'm sorry. But right now, to this point, you haven't shown that.
Okay. Let me keep reading.
Okay.
I would.
And this is voluntary abortion.
Right. This isn't
No, this is involuntary. We're forcing people to
No. That's not what he meant. He meant like, you know, the birth of the baby is going to cause the mom or the baby to die. That's what he means. Like,
someone could go into a quote unquote clinic.
Right.
What abortion is not voluntary?
That's what I'm saying is that that falls under the
medical necessity.
Like, nobody has told you that there's going to be an adverse effect for delivering the baby, either for you or your child. And so that is considered a voluntary thing.
Right.
Versus,
it's not considered a miscarriage.
Right. And it's not considered
if you get a car wreck. And you're knocked out and show up at the hospital and your leg's broken beyond whatever, and it's either you're dead or they cut your leg off. It's not voluntary for you that they cut your leg off. It is a medical necessity.
Correct. And in this situation, it could be, well...
So that's not voluntary.
that's not considered voluntary in this particular medical terminology.
So I'm talking about that's what I'm talking about. He said voluntary.
Right.
Yeah.
And what we're trying to explain is what the inverse of, or what the opposite of voluntary means in this conversation is not involuntary in the sense that it's somebody is just stealing you and
forcing
doing
you.
It. Right. It's that it is for your medical best interest. It is medically involuntary. How's that for
that's better,
kind
yeah.
of pushing
that's
it together?
Probably better, yeah. Where the baby would not survive, it would be stillbirth, or the likelihood of you surviving the birth is very, very low. And so as a result of that, you have an abortion to eliminate both the stillbirth or the potential demise of you as the carrier.
Right, so the opposite being medical necessity, not...
Involuntary,
right. That's I'm trying to
I know.
Clean up the
it's,
terms there.
Right. It's not good terminology. I mean, I'll admit that.
Right.
I'm saying, as far as I know...
Yeah, I see it.
Most states that I know of, you can't walk into an abortion clinic at a certain point and just be like, I'd like to get an abortion.
Right.
Like, most of them, it's within, like, 5 weeks. Six weeks.
I don't know.
After that, they're like... No, we can't do anything for you.
I don't know about the specifics of that. I have a friend of mine that had an abortion at 8 weeks, and it was here in Tennessee. And like anything over that particular time frame, I think it was either 9 or 10, they had to go to Georgia. Because Georgia's, you know, laws on how far along you are is, you know, and then it becomes an issue of, like, what happens if you call and, like, their next appointment is in 3 weeks? Well, hell, if you're at 8 weeks, you're fucked. What are you going to do then? You're at 11 then.
Yeah. Well, because I know one of the things Tennessee's got a problem with is the way they, like, they're the restrictions on numbers of clinics available or something like that. Like, there's only so many available in the state, and that's by law. It's not because there's not willing doctors and stuff like that. It's just it's by law there's only so many in. I think it's broken down by section of state too. Like, it's like West Tennessee gets 4 or something like that. Middle Tennessee has 4.
The other thing too that I take issue with, this is just a side note, and this is a hot button topic for a lot of conservatives, is I don't understand why that there's this press to defund Planned Parenthood when such a significant portion of the budget for Planned Parenthood actually isn't for abortions. It's for contraceptives and, like, sex education and that sort of stuff. Like, the overwhelming majority of their budget is actually for that sort of stuff, not for let's go in with a coat hanger and kill some babies.
Right.
And but, like, that seems to be a politically charged issue that gets votes for.
Well, it goes into the same conversation about the transmilitary thing. It's like, you're spending my money on what? Regardless of how much of the whole money you take, you're spending my money on what?
If that's the case, then they should just eliminate the abortion from that particular service and not eliminate the service altogether.
Hold on.
Right.
You know? So I understand your point of view, AC. And I understand what you believe. Not saying you are believing anything different than what you believe. But my mother has been fighting abortion for over 20-some years. And Planned Parenthood, especially. My mom has been arrested probably 30 times from protesting at abortion clinics. She has went into to Planned Parenthood and pretended like she was pregnant. And every single time she went into Planned Parenthood pretending she was pregnant, they have pushed her to abortion. They have not pushed her to adoption. They have not pushed her to anything. And my mom has tried to see the side of Planned Parenthood. And whether it was in Wyoming, Nebraska, Colorado, Indiana, Florida, Louisiana, Texas, all the places she has been arrested protesting at a Planned Parenthood, every single clinic has pushed her to abortion. And so from somebody that has been on the other side of that, Planned Parenthood is not about preventing pregnancy. It's not about contraceptives. It's not about anything. Planned Parenthood makes 100%. Well, I say 100%. I'll take that back. A majority of their money off of abortions.
My point was, if so, they get federal monies. My point is, if we want to eliminate abortions from Planned Parenthood, then we should just say that, and the other things that they do aside from abortions, we should still let that happen. That's all I was saying. I don't care enough about the abortion topic to even get into it, frankly. I'm just saying that if we want, at a federal level, if we want to eliminate Planned Parenthood from providing abortions, we should focus on that. The other stuff that they do, which is sex education and provide contraceptives and all that stuff, they should still let that happen.
According to their mandate or their stuff, they say they're for other things. It's kind of like me and Seth. They're like, oh, we want to quit. We want people to quit smoking, but we don't want people to quit nicotine. You know, we want them to throw down cigarettes. We want them to stop smoking. We want them to do that stuff. But realistically, we don't want them to quit nicotine. We want them to be on vape for fucking ever.
I mean, I don't think Planned Parenthood is saying we don't want you to have sex. I think they're just saying that we don't want you to have sex without protection.
No, they absolutely want you to have sex with protection, because giving out a condom versus charging you for abortion. What's your business plan?
I don't even know what the hell we're even arguing here. Like it's gotten way out of hand.
No, but you were saying that Planned Parenthood is not about abortion.
It's not what it said.
Yeah, it is.
You said they're not exclusively.
They're not
about
exclusively
abortion.
About abortion. That's exactly. They're about what other stuff.
They are.
They may give that premise of they're about other stuff, but they make their money off abortion.
Like, if you look this up, this is a fucking fact. Federal dollars that go to Planned Parenthood, more than 50% of the federal dollars go for things other than abortions. That is a fact. It is.
So the money goes to Planned Parenthood.
From tax dollars
mm-hmm. for not abortions.
That's not what I said. I said more than 50% of the money that the federal government is giving to Planned Parenthood is for things other than abortions. It's what I'm saying.
So the money goes to Planned Parenthood, not for abortions. That's what you're saying.
How else can I say this?
No, I'm just trying to. You're saying that a majority of the money that goes to Planned Parenthood is not for abortions.
Right, and maybe 49% of it goes for abortions.
So 51% of the money. How that money that goes to Planned Parenthood? How does the government track where that money goes for? How do they justify that?
What do you mean? What do you mean justify?
I give you $100 and I say you need to spend $49 on alcohol, not 51% on alcohol. How do I justify that?
I mean, I can find that out and bring it to our next podcast, but I assume that since it's federal dollars, there's some sort of auditing process that goes.
No, it's the fucking federal government.
Okay. Like, we're going into conspiracy theory stuff here. Like,
we're not going into conspiracy theory.
We're not, then. Like, I don't know what you want me to say, dude. Like, all I can tell you is all of the Republicans that want to remove Planned Parenthood, period, say that the reason why they want to remove Planned Parenthood is for the abortion reason. And I'm saying that the abortion thing that Planned Parenthood does is not 51% of the services that they provide. That's all I'm saying.
Whether it's money or not, but it's not necessarily money anyway. All right, so let's push off this and close on something more fun, and then we'll call it a night.
Okay.
Let's talk about something different. Football. We had football on TV.
Football.
Tennessee lost today. Surprise.
I'm shocked.
I mean, I hit my over by halftime, so I was good. Bama shit the bed. Florida lost. That's cool.
Did Bama's not shit in the bed?
I mean, they're shit in the bed.
Not really. They're down. I mean, they're up by, what is that?
Well, when you took them winning by 23 and a half, they're shit in the bed.
Well, it's Lane Kiffin. I mean, he knows a lot about his dad. Here's a joke.
Dun, 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 dun.
Okay. He put out some weight. Kiffin?
I think he's trimmed down a little bit. He's not as chunky. I was like,
is that really Kiffin?
I was like, he's still kind of chubby.
Well, his whole thing where, like, I when he came here, I always thought it was funny that he wore, like, it looked like he still wore Philip Fulmer's stuff. Like, everything, he always wore huge, like, he always had big clothes on. Like,
now he needs it.
Yeah. Maybe that's what it was. He's like, I want to fit my clothes. I don't know why I get extra larges, but I need to get in them. So, all right, that counts as fun. 31 in the books, bitches. Got hot and heavy.
Yeah.
got serious, got fun. So we are almost in agreement at gmail.com, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. I was thinking about opening a MySpace page just for funnies. Probably not going to do it. We're on most major podcast providers. If we're not on one that you like, shoot me an email and I'll see if I can figure out how to get on there. That's it for us. I don't have anything specifically in the pipeline right now, but Ron McPherson, but that's in a couple weeks. So, again, we're almost in agreement, and we'll talk to you all later.